In the Old Testament, Jesus said, "All who hate me love death." Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. Accepting him as your Lord and Savior and choosing to follow him puts you on the way. Obeying the truth of God's word keeps you on the way that ends in eternal life. Your eternal destiny will be determined by your choices in this world. Steps to Life exists to help people find the way, the truth, and the life.
Christian's hope is becoming more wonderful to you every day. Before we begin to study God's Word together, let's pray that the Lord will help us to understand what we'll study. Father in heaven, we come to you now realizing our need of a Savior, our need of the ministration of the Holy Spirit. And we earnestly pray that by the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, our worship may be acceptable in the sight of our Redeemer and to our Father, to you in heaven. We pray that you will give to each of us a clear mind to study and understand what you want to do for us. Help us to understand that you're planning to do far more for us than we can ask or think. And help us to escape our unbelief and to have perfect trust and confidence in you. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. You have your Bible? I want to study the following text of Scripture with you today. It's in 1 John. 1 John, the third chapter, one verse. Now, this verse has an interesting context, a very interesting context. We could spend all of our time studying about the context of this verse, but we're not going to do that. We're just going to look at the verse itself. Is 1 John 3, verse 14. It says, "We know that we have passed from death to life because we love the brethren. He who does not love his brother abides in death." I thought of many ways and much to say that could be said to introduce our subject. I decided we're not going to engage in any kind of preliminaries. We're going to come directly to the point. So I want to ask you a question right at the beginning. Why is it so difficult for people in this world to love each other? Well, people say, "You don't know how this person treated me." And, yeah, I don't know. Why is it so difficult to love each other? Well, there are several reasons, of course. But one of the reasons, one of the big reasons that is involved is because of the devil's confusing counterfeits for love. So when people, they say they love somebody, they don't, that's not even true. They don't, I'm not accusing them of deliberately telling a lie, but it's not even true because the devil's confusing counterfeits for love have people in this world so mixed up that they do not know what love is. So many examples. Here's just one quick example of the confusion in the world about love. In 2000 AD, I was in Miami, Florida. I was in the courtroom, about 10th floor up, high-rise building. And the General Conference of Seventh-day Adventists was suing Rafael Perez because of his newspaper ads and calling himself, calling his church Seventh-day Adventist Church and so forth. And so one of the things that came out, people said to him, "You, what you're doing, you hate the Catholics." And he said, "No, He said, I'm doing this because I love the Catholics. And I thought, isn't this interesting? He has Seventh-day Adventist ministers. Some say, this shows that you hate the Catholics. And others say, no, this shows that I love the Catholics. Is there any confusion about what love is? The devil has many counterfeits for love, and that's one of the reasons there's so much confusion. I want to mention, first of all, the worst counterfeit for love that the devil has. And all the other counterfeits actually are spin-offs of this worst counterfeit for love. In the devil's government, love of self is called love. But love of self is the exact opposite of love. That's selfishness. That's the same as calling darkness light or calling black white. Very few people in our world, when a person says, I love this or I love that, realize that what they're really saying is they're simply referring to the fact that this thing or person, whatever it is so pleasant and gratifying to some appetite or passion or desire that I have. So they say they love whatever it is, food, a person. The word love is so commonly used in this way that from babyhood, people hear an opposite definition of love. And so they think that love is just something that makes you happy, makes you feel good, satisfies some appetite or passion or pleasure that you have. So I've said to people, there's lots of people that are married and they say, I love you. They never loved their spouse ever once. They love themselves. And they got married because of what their spouse could do for them. That's not love. If you got married because of something your spouse was going to be able to do for you, that's not love at all. You're selfish. I remember my father told me a story of people that they know they've been married about 40 years or more. One day the husband came home and said to his wife, I'm leaving home. I've never loved you. I thought to myself, yeah, that's truth. He never loved her. He was selfish. You see, if you love somebody, you don't get married because of what they can do for you. You get married because of what you can do for them. And it's a complete opposite. I mean, it's just complete opposite. Here's what Ellen White wrote about it. This is recorded in several places. It's in Counsel on Health, page 76, several other places. He said, there is but little real, genuine, devoted, pure love. This precious article is very rare. Some children have never seen it. Passion is termed love. That's one of the devil's counterfeits for love. Somebody says, I love you. What they really mean is, I'm passionate for you. Real love, is, she says, is very rare. Another one of the devil's counterfeits for love is that people think that love is a feeling. It's a feeling that you have for somebody or something. That's what they mean when they say they love this person or love something. They have this feeling. Let me read you what Ellen White said about that idea. Love is a precious gift which we receive from Jesus. Pure and holy affection is not a feeling, but a principle. Those who are actuated by true love are neither unreasonable nor blind. I remember when I first heard about this idea that love, because I grew up in the real world just like you did, with all this craziness, crazy definitions that are all wrong, there's what to talk about. Very difficult for most children to learn what love is unless they're children of parents who are true Christians. And I remember when I first heard this idea that love is not a feeling, but a principle. And I thought, well, okay, if it's a principle, give me more definition. Well, maybe there's somebody here that's asking that same question. Well, if it's a principle, tell me what the principle is. I'll try. You pray for me. Love is a principle that causes my thoughts, my feelings, and my words, and my actions to come into perfect harmony with the law of God. That's what love is. If my thoughts, my feelings, my words, and my actions are contrary to the love of God, I do not have Christ's love in my heart, no matter what I claim. In the New Testament, the apostles had the job to try to convey and explain to the world what love is. And they knew more about love than any people who had ever lived before on the face of the earth, because not only had they been with Jesus for over 3 years, but they had been with him at the closing scenes of his life. My subject today is not specifically the cross of Christ, but I will say this. If you ever really experience it, I didn't mean just know the story. If you ever really experience it, you'll have a little glimmer of the infinite love of God enter into your mind. You'll start to understand something you never understood before. Paul wrote to the Romans. He was writing especially about the second table of the law, but that would include the first table of the law, although he was writing especially about the second table of the law. He said, love does no harm to his neighbor. So love is the fulfilling of the law. The Apostle Paul, in his epistles, as well as the other apostles, he tries to explain this love so that a person that wasn't at the cross, that never experienced that, could start to understand it. He wrote his most complete description to the Corinthian church in 1 Corinthians 13, and he told them that love is patient. It's patient. It doesn't make a judgment before examining the evidence. He told them that love is kind. It does not attempt to judge the heart or motives of his brother. He told them that it was not jealous or envious. He told them that it was never boastful. Love would not make a person come to sweeping conclusions about things that they've never studied out. He said that love was never proud. It does not manifest pride of opinion. Love does not demand its own way. I have a friend in another state, not in Kansas. Sometimes when we're visiting together, we discuss theology. You ever discuss theology with some of your friends? So we've discussed different things. We agree on most things, but we don't understand everything just the same. But we're friends, and we know we don't understand everything just the same. And I told him, one time we were talking about it, you know, how could I explain it in different words? If I'm wrong, I want to know I'm wrong. I want you to help me find out that I'm wrong, but I want you to show me that I'm wrong from the Scriptures. He said, all right, I'll see what I can do. He's a good friend of mine. So he sent me a letter, he mailed me a letter. I've been studying it for a few months. He's got tons of Scriptures and Spirit of Prophecy quotations and so forth in it. Another characteristic of love is that it does not hold grudges. And this is very, very difficult for us to do. Do you know anybody who has made a serious mistake? And as a result of the serious mistake that they made, you have suffered a severe loss. Some years ago, a Seventh-day Adventist man and myself were working on a project. I didn't have time to do it or even get involved in it, so I hired him to do it. And we had an agreement. He was going to do certain things for me, and I was going to pay him the money to do it. I paid him several thousand dollars. Project never got done. Finally, he drove up here. This was several years ago. He drove up here to Wichita. I was sitting with him in his car. And he told me, said, I'm sorry. Says, I can't get it done. And all I can do is ask you to forgive me. So I said, okay, I forgive you. And afterward, I thought to myself, you know, if he'd have done what he agreed with me he was going to do, we'd probably both made a few thousand dollars. But now as a result of this, I'm going to lose at least maybe $15,000. I'm going to be paying for years to get straightened out of this. And as I was thinking about it, I wasn't happy thinking about it. I don't know if you'd be happy thinking about something like that. I wasn't happy. And I was thinking about it, and I thought, well, you owe Jesus Christ something that you'll never be able to repay. So I cannot hold a grudge against this man because he can't pay me. Can't pay back. Sometimes we get into situations where love is difficult to do because of our human nature. But Paul said love is the only thing that's going to last. Someday prophecies will fail, and nobody will speak in unknown languages. And the only people left in the church will be those who have received and then developed the love of Jesus by patient continuance in well-doing. Remember, the Apostle Paul said that love is not proud. Love is humble. And until I become humble, I can never learn the lesson of love or never really have it. And the disciples, Ellen White tells us that the disciples that Jesus chose were all humble men. They were humble. But as they associated with Jesus, as his closest followers, they looked forward to the setting up of the kingdom. And as they were his closest associates in the world, they looked forward to becoming officers in the coming kingdom. And although these disciples were from humble backgrounds, they were ambitious people. And as they looked about their number, they wondered who Christ would give the chief positions to in the coming kingdom. They wondered what position that he would give to them, each one of them, and also their fellow disciples. And as they thought about these things, unfortunately, they lost a lot of the humility that they had when Jesus called them. Now, I'm going to bring this right up to date. What I'm talking about is not something that just happened 2,000 years ago. It happens all the time in the church today. And it happened in Ellen White's day, and she wrote a lot about it. I want to read you just one paragraph about this. He says, "The greatest trials that have come upon the church have been brought about through the agency of those who were its professed friends and who had been placed in positions of trust and sacred responsibility. Our most sanguine expectations have been frequently disappointed. We have followed our best judgment in selecting men for places of trust, and they have failed time and again when the test was brought to bear on their characters. They have exhibited weaknesses of which they gave no previous indication. They are not what they appeared to be before they were placed in the position. How often have we finite beings been led to repent that we have used our influence toward promoting men who afterwards have given no evidence of their devotion to God's word and work? We have often inquired what has made this great change in these men. What was it that led Saul to presume upon his exaltation to dishonor God by unbelief and disobedience? It was self-sufficiency and an evil heart of unbelief. It was when Saul was little in his own sight that God chose him to be ruler over Israel. But when he lost his spirit of simplicity and humility, he was not the man for the place, and his authority was taken from him. Those who turn from their humility and begin to exalt self are filled with the most unaccountable infatuation and self-deception in regard to their own qualifications. Like Saul, they begin to assume responsibilities that their position in no wise warrants and for which God has not ordained them." And that's exactly what started happening with Jesus' own disciples. You can read it in any one of the Gospels. They started saying, "See, which one of us is really going to be the top dog in the kingdom of heaven?" All the disciples looked to Judas as being a likely candidate to be the prime minister in the new kingdom. But inside their hearts, they thought that maybe they should have the leading position instead of Judas. And finally, James and John, who were part of the group of three that were with Jesus everywhere in the house of Jairus, whose daughter's dead, on the Mount of Transfiguration, later in the Garden of Gethsemane, they decided that it would be more appropriate for them to have the chief positions in the kingdom than for Judas. And they got their mother's help, and they went to Jesus. They thought that it would be better for them to be the prime ministers than for either Judas or Peter, who somehow let his tongue get ahead of his mind, his reason. They They had their mother ask Jesus to appoint them to the top positions in the kingdom. And you can read about it in Matthew 20. The 10, when they heard about it, they were angry. The reason they were angry is because they also wanted the top positions in the kingdom. That led to a very interesting short speech by Jesus to his disciples about the difference between the kingdoms of this world and his kingdom. Read it yourself in Matthew 20. I can't get going on that. That requires a whole sermon of itself to just explain Matthew 20, 20, 28. But they kept on going on. In fact, the night, turn in your Bible to Luke, Gospel of Luke, 22nd chapter. Luke 22, verse 24. Now, this is in the upper room when the Lord's Supper was instituted that we plan to, I won't be here, but Pastor Domingo is going to conduct the communion service and have ordinance of foot washing here next week. And this was when it was first ordained by Jesus Christ, first instituted by Jesus Christ. This was the night that he was betrayed. And look what was going on. Verse 24. There was also rivalry among them as to which of them should be considered the greatest. They were arguing about who was going to have the highest place in the coming kingdom. This is why none of them offered to act the part of a servant. That would have offended their self-respect. So Jesus washed their feet. And they were so embarrassed that he was washing their feet and that they were not washing his feet that they never forgot the lesson. And by the way, it is a lesson that we all must learn if we are going to be in the kingdom of heaven. And then after Jesus had washed their feet, it's recorded, turn to John 13. After Jesus had washed their feet, turn to John 13. Starting with verse 31. The Son of Man is glorified and God is glorified in him. That's what he said when Judas went out. Verse 32. If God is glorified in him, God will also glorify him in himself and glorify him immediately. Little children, I shall be with you a little while longer. You will seek me, and as I said to the Jews, where I am going, you cannot come. So now I say to you, a new commandment I give to you, that you love one another as I have loved you, that you also love one another. By this all will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another. I'm going to give you a new commandment. Interestingly enough, this was not a new commandment. This commandment was given by Moses in Leviticus 19. It was not new, but it was new to them because they hadn't been doing it. And it was at that time that Peter, when Jesus told his disciples that they were all going to be offended because of him that night, they were all going to forsake him. By the way, the Bible says that love never becomes offended.
My dear friend, if
he was treated terrible, but if Jesus had become offended by the way he was treated, you and I would all be lost. Peter became really upset. He was offended when Jesus said that you're all going to be offended because of me this night and you're all going to leave me this night. And Peter said, I will not. He directly contradicted the Lord. I will not be offended this night because of you. Jesus, I love you so much. I will go with you to death. I would die for you. I'll never be offended. I'll never forsake you. Let me ask you a question. Do you know yourself? Very few people know themselves. Of course, nobody knows himself perfectly. Only the Lord knows us perfectly. The Lord knows everything that is in the heart of man. But there are a lot of people today just like Peter. They think they have the love of Jesus in their hearts. Peter, I love you so much, I would die for you. But they're totally mistaken. Sometimes they are so mistaken that everybody else can see it except them. And Jesus said then to Peter, said, this night, before the cock crows twice, you are going to deny me three times. Peter again contradicted, absolutely not. I will never do anything like that. My dear friend, you and I are coming to a time of great crisis. A greater crisis than any crisis since Christ's first advent. A time of trial. Do you ever pray and say, Lord, when I'm tested, help me not to deny you like Peter did. When I'm tested, help me not to betray you like Judas did. You ever pray like that? You know what happened to Peter. You know the story. I'm not telling you a story you don't know. He denied the Lord with cursing and swearing. Now I want you to, some people have never studied out and never thought through how serious this is. I want you to see how serious this is. Look in your Bible in Leviticus 24. Leviticus 24. We read verses 10 to 15. Now the son of an Israelite woman whose father was an Egyptian went out among the children of Israel, and this Israelite's woman's son and a man of Israel fought each other in the camp. And the Israelite's woman said, blaspheme the name of the Lord, and cursed. And so they brought him to Moses. His mother's name was Shelomith, and the daughter of Dibri of the tribe of Dan. Then they put him in custody, that the mind of the Lord might be shown to them. And the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, take outside the camp him who has cursed. Then let all who heard him lay their hands on his head, and let all the congregation stone him. Then you shall speak to the children of Israel, saying, whoever curses his God shall bear his sin. Did the Jewish leaders know what Moses wrote? They certainly did. Did the Jewish leaders know that Peter had done something that the penalty for doing it was be stoned to death? They did. The disciples knew it too. So the disciples, they knew that, the rest of the disciples knew that he was not a part of their member, that he could never be part of the church anymore. He had divorced himself from the church. That is why on resurrection morning, when the angel spoke to those who had come to the tomb, he said, go tell his disciples and Peter. You ever notice that? Why did he say, go tell the disciples and Peter? Before Peter could be officially part of the church again, what he had done wrong must not only be forgiven, but must be made right. And the record of that is in John 21. Look at John 21. Start reading in verse 15. So when they had eaten breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of Jonah, do you love me more than these?" He said to him, "Yes, Lord. You know that I love you." He said to him, "Feed my lambs." He said to him again a second time, "Simon, son of Jonah, do you love me?" He said to him, "Yes, Lord. You know that I love you." He said to him, "Tend my sheep." He said to him the third time, "Simon, son of Jonah, do you have affection for me?" He said, "Lord, you know everything. You know that I have affection for you." Jesus said, "Feed my sheep." And it was at that time, not only Jesus did he reinstate Peter as an apostle, he told him what was going to happen in the future, that he was going to die himself by crucifixion. Now suppose that after Peter confessed his love for his Lord three times, the same number of times that he had denied his Lord, that Jesus had said to him, "You know, Peter, the rest of the disciples are not sure what to do about you. You know that under the old covenant, you would have been stoned to death for what you have done. The rest of the disciples are concerned for the reputation of the church. And you know, Peter, that this was not a sin of ignorance. And that the name and character of the church, so that it not be dragged through the dust, so the Jews will not say that the Christians have no standards. They don't keep the law," because that's exactly what they would say, "because the Jewish leaders all know that you committed a sin for which you would be stoned to death, according to the law. And some of the disciples think that for the safety and reputation of the church and the world, it would be better if you didn't attend church for a while. But Peter, because of my infinite love and mercy for you, I'm going not only to forgive you, but I'm going to restore to you full fellowship and membership in the church. But in order to protect the reputation of the church from scandal, I will not be able to make you an apostle again. You can be a church member, but you will never be able to be an elder or an apostle or an officer of the church again, because the name and the reputation of the church must not be scandalized." My friends, that, what I just told you, is the exact gospel. Not the gospel here in the Bible, but that is the exact gospel that I was taught when I was studying theology to become a Seventh-day Adventist minister. I was a freshman theology major at Walla Walla College, preparing for the ministry. And I was taught the exact gospel that I just explained to you. And you know who it was that taught it to me? The associate secretary of the ministerial department of the General Conference visited our class. Now, I already knew this man, because many years before, when I was a boy, and before he was ever in the General Conference, when he was visiting our town, my father had invited him home to our house for dinner. In fact, I can still see him at our table, at my parents' table, eating watermelon for dessert that Sabbath. And he told us He said, you need to understand this. You're going to be a Seventh-day Adventist minister. There are two things that you can never do, and if you do either one of them, you will be out of the Adventist ministry, and you will never become an Adventist minister again. You'll never be an Adventist minister again. You'll forever be debarred from being an Adventist minister. Now, I not only got acquainted with this man that told us that when I was a child, I knew him later. In fact, when I was a young minister in North Dakota, I again ate dinner with this minister at the house of the conference president. He was not only one of the most talented ministers that we had, he was a person that keep you riveted to your seat. He was also one of the most interesting conversationalists at the dinner table. In fact, he was the chief conversationalist at the dinner table when I was there. And I heard what he said, and I knew he was a godly man, and I believed it. I didn't check it out. I believed it, and I believed it for many years. I believed it from then on for many years, and I knew the Spirit of Prophecy quotations that were used to back up that position. But there were some Seventh-day Adventist ministers in Texas that studied this out, and they decided that we were not doing what was right. And they said, there are ministers who have grievously sinned and tarnished the reputation of the church, but who have sincerely repented and are living in harmony with the commandments of God for years. And these people could be redeemed. And they could serve again as gospel workers and receive credentials as ministers for the Seventh-day Adventist Church. Now, one of the leaders in Texas who believed this was a minister by the name of Elder Ben Leach. When our family went out to Texas in 1979, because I was going to work at Southwestern Adventist College, I got acquainted with Elder Ben Leach because he was the chairman of the board for the college and he was also the Union Conference president. And in spite of what you may have heard, because scurrilous reports have gone on about him all over the country for years, about errors or mistakes that he made. By the way, all human leaders make mistakes. James and Ellen White made mistakes and confessed their mistakes and weren't hesitant to do it. But in spite of human mistakes, Elder Ben Leach was a godly man. I know that. I have prayed with him in his office myself. So Elder Ben Leach went to the General Conference leaders, and at a meeting he said, we have a new plan in the Texas Conference. We call it the Redemption Plan. And let me tell you, there were Adventist leaders that were not happy about what he was doing. At one time, some of the top leaders in the General Conference came to Texas to try to oust him. They were unsuccessful, but reports went all over the country about Elder Leach and others there doing these things, and they were thought totally unworthy to be in a position of Adventist leadership. And they said, we've read the Spirit of Prophecy too. We've read the statements that contradict what you're doing, as though the Spirit of Prophecy would contradict Jesus. And they said, we know he's wrong. Now, my friends, did you notice carefully what we were reading in John 21? Jesus did not just forgive Peter. He did not just restore him to full fellowship in the church. He reinstated him as an apostle. with the same office, function, and authority as the other apostles. Even the Roman Catholic Church understands this. So, my friends, the new plan was new to Seventh-day Adventists, but it wasn't really new at all. Jesus instituted it 2,000 years ago. The redemption plan was not created by Elder Leach. It was created by Jesus Christ, and I read it to you in John 21. Under the old covenant, Peter would have been stoned. But in the new covenant, not only was he forgiven and made a church member again, but he was fully reinstated to his previous office as a church leader. Notice what the Apostle Paul says about this whole situation. Look at Acts 13. Very interesting scripture. Paul was preaching. Here's what he said. Therefore, let it be known to you, brethren, that through this man is preached to you the forgiveness of sins, and by him everyone who believes is justified from all things from which you could not be justified by law of Moses. So the new plan was actually the old plan. It was new to Seventh-day Adventists, but it was actually an old plan that Jesus had instituted 2,000 years ago. It's just like when Jesus gave his disciples the new commandment. He said, I'm giving you a new commandment. Was it really new? Absolutely not. It was the old commandment. Why was it new? Because they hadn't been doing it. When Elder Leach introduced his new plan, the redemption plan, to the General Conference, it was actually not a new plan at all. It was the old plan that Jesus preached, practiced, and we read in John 21. Elder Leach didn't create the redemption plan. Jesus did that 2,000 years ago. And my friends, many years ago, I decided that I wanted to be part of the redemption plan.
Do you realize, friends, that the people that you and I consider are the worst sinners are not the people that God considers the worst sinners? Have you ever thought that through?
I could give a whole sermon on that from the Bible and Spirit of Prophecy, but you can study it out for yourself. I decided if I wanted to be part of the redemption plan, and I do, that I would have to extend the redemption plan to others who had repented and reformed, even if they were the chief of sinners. My dear friends, the Adventists have a long ways to go to be ready for the kingdom of heaven. We are in desperate need of prayer, of revival, and reformation. And I want to tell you a quick story. Because the subject I'm talking about, there are many souls being lost over this, all over the country and all over the world. A number of years ago, there was a man who had committed a heinous crime. And the state had put him in prison. And while he was in prison, I don't know, I have no idea really how he got it, but he got a hold of a copy of Landmarks magazine. Started reading this magazine. Decided he wanted to become a Christian. Then he decided he wanted to become an Adventist Christian. Which he did. He became a Seventh-day Adventist. And the time came when he was let out of prison. He was let out of prison, but he was still on probation. And so he was an Adventist now. He wanted to go to an Adventist church. And when the people in this Adventist church, it wasn't a huge church, when the people in this church found out about this man, who he was, a large proportion of the church didn't want to allow him to come to church. Dude, those people are too dangerous, you know. When I was in that area of the country several years ago, been out of prison a short time, I went up to visit him in his apartment. He'd been able to get a job, working full time. He had no family. He was all alone. It would have been very nice if he'd had a church family. Do you understand that in a situation like that, a person just doesn't feel right? It doesn't feel welcome in the church? Let me ask you something. Do you think that there's anybody in this town that might come to our church if they felt comfortable, but they're afraid that they would just wouldn't feel comfortable here? You think there's anybody like that? One time there was a visitor that visited this church. He sat right back there in the back row, right over there. And afterwards, I met him, talked with him, told me quite a bit about himself, actually.
And I felt that I had to tell him the truth.
So here's what I told him. I said, don't tell anybody here what you've done. Now, I'm not saying I did the right thing. I don't know whether I did the right thing or the wrong thing. That's what I felt that I had to say. I hope you can figure out why I had to say it. Well, guess what? He didn't feel comfortable coming here. And so I've been praying about this actually for a long time. And I'm not pointing a finger at anybody of you. I'm as bad as anybody. I'll put it in first person. Can I overcome my formalism, my Phariseeism enough so that sinners can be saved and not feel, you know, Jesus never let these sinners know that what they had done shocked him. And Ellen White says it did shock him, but he never let them know.
Friends, we need to pray that we can get there.
I've talked long enough. Let's pray. Our Father in heaven, we want to see a revival and a reformation happen in our own personal lives. We want to help each other have the same experience that you want us all to have. And Lord, by your grace and power, we want you to use each one of us as instruments to save sinners. And we pray that your Spirit will transform us into the people we need to be so this can happen. And we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
We hope that this sermon has been a blessing to you. We would love to hear from you. Our mailing address is Steps to Life, P.O. Box 782-828, Wichita, Kansas 67278. You may call us at 1-800-THE-TRUTH. That's 1-800-843-8788. Our email address is historic@stepstolife.org, and our web address is www.stepstolife.org. May God be with you as you seek to walk the narrow way.